they asked me to speak actually about what he did and this. That's the status of canonical quantum gravity. Where is canonical quantum gravity today? So I'm not going to do this job, I'm just we'll talk about two issues which I think are very foundational, and which is basically what is observable in quantum gravity and what is vacuum, and in a sense it's basically what is nothing and how can we know that there is actually something. And actually it's easier to start with the second part. So what can we observe? And this is where canonical quantization comes in. So if you open a book on canonical quantization, then it gives you this funny recipe. Take your phase-based functions, or take your observables, and put heads over it. Canonical quantization. you know, I mean, in more technical terms, find the Hilbert space, the representation of your observable algebra, so that the Poisson commutators are nicely mapped, as nicely as possible, to commutators. If you try to do that for quantum gravity, you first have to say, okay, what are actually the physical observables? And then if you open other standard books, it tells you, well, there are actually no explicit physical observables known. So that's, you know, the first question you should ask, what is actually observable? How can we actually start to quantize? And there's a very elaborate, there's a usual procedure called Dirac quantization, where you first avoid this problem. But nevertheless, at some point, let's discuss what could be observables in our system. And usually this is called the problem of time, also I don't really like it to call it the problem of time. So the problem is that diffeomorphic symmetry, which is coordinate naively coordinate transformation, that this is usually seen as a gauge symmetry of general relativity. And these include time translations.
Yes, sorry, could you stand either left or right?
Yeah, let me.
Great.
So these include time translations, which means these are really gauge symmetries. And physical observables should be gauge invariant, which just means they should not depend on your choice of arbitrary coordinates. And hence, physical observables should also be constant in your auxiliary choice of time. And this is usually called the problem of time or the frozen time formalism, because naively you would say, okay, everything has to be a constant of motion in the end. So there's kind of a naive solution to that relation of observables, that you express everything in terms, in relations between different degrees of freedom or between different fields, and it's a very old idea, which truly goes back to Einstein, but then there's Bergmann, which worked a lot on that, Kuprasch, Rovelli, and so on. So the problem is that, you know, if you do quantum mechanics, then you have basically as an observer the position of your particle, and usually it's understood the position of your particle now, and this is not an observer. But, you know, an equivalent relational thing is if you ask what is a particle, where's the position of the particle at 5 p.m. and then you have to explain what you understand under 5 p.m. and this is on Daniele's clock. We come to this point. And this is a much better defined observable because it tells you, you know, when the reference point is Daniele's clock and it has to show 5 p.m. and then I want to know what is the position of the particle. And in principle, it also allows you an evolution because you can ask where is the particle at 6 p.m., at 7 p.m., and so on. So in principle, this allows you to regain, in this simple example, all standard quantum mechanics in a slightly more elaborate language. You get, in principle, also a physical Hamiltonian that evolves Daniele and the rest of the universe, but actually not his clock. It's kind of scary for Daniele to be evolved, but... So, you know, we can actually solve this problem of time modulo some practical problems, or maybe also some more foundational problems. So the practical problem is, in principle, you need these observables, you know, explicitly, and since it's the position of some particle at 5 pm, and we don't have 5 pm, in principle, you know, you would have to calculate where is this particle at 5 pm given your initial data. And this might be slightly complicated, but you know, you ask your next physicist, and it can be done in principle. So you need to solve the dynamics of the theory. So maybe we can do that in 50 years, but that is basically the slightly more practical problem. The more foundational problem is, what are good clocks? And do we have any good clocks? And you know, also there's another problem. If you carry a planet around you, it's actually like good clocks should better not be too heavy, especially in winter, apparently.
Thanks, Ben.
but in principle, you know, again, relational observables can be used and are actually widely applied, especially in quantum cosmology. And this introduction of a clock even allows you to circumvent problem A, which was to solve the theory, because you can apply a procedure which is called deparametrization, which you could also understand as finding a nice gauge fixing, or finding a nice one-parameter family of gauge fixing, where this one-parameter family denotes basically the different times. And this, again, means a nice system of clocks. They are nice. I'm going to explain in a second what it means. The problem, again, is to find nice clocks here. Let me just mention that, for instance, a round, flat, and homogeneous phase-space points, so that means a round, flat space, that would be a nice phase-space point, or in cosmology, clocks are actually provided by standard gauge fixing. So with that I mean, for instance, cosmology, the longitudinal gauge is used, and you can use that to express, to really construct gauge invariant variables, which are very, you know, which are very good in phase space around these homogeneous phase space points. They are, however, highly non-local, because in principle, like this longitudinal gauge actually gives you an observable on slices with a notion of time, which is highly non-local in the sense that it asks what is some observable on a hypersurface which is r straight as possible in a given manifold. And this r straight as possible is basically formulated as conditions on symmetric components, and they involve differential operators. And so in principle, if you calculate, you have to invert this, and you ask a very non-local question. If you basically evolve that, you get in principle lots of integrals and so on. But nevertheless, it allows you to formulate like such question, to discuss such question like the fluctuation of light cones or causal structure in terms of gauge invariant variables. So, you know, if you are happy with kind of going to some approximate situations, you always can find clocks which are good enough in certain situations, and that is basically the general idea here. Another kind of approach is basically, I call them ether approaches. Which is basically, if there are no good clocks, and good clocks would mean, you know, things which always go monotonously forward, which don't appear as p squared in your constraints and so on, let's add them to the system. And so I think the first one who really started it more or less systematically was actually Kukash. And he had, you know, he wrote different busy meta Lagrangians that gave you different gauge fixings in principle. But
sorry, what does them refer to? Bad clocks? Is there
no
good clocks? No,
sorry, the good clocks.
Oh.
Add good clocks to the system.
Oh, add good clocks. Okay.
So you add, for instance, a fluid, and then if you sit yourself, you know, on this fluid, you get effectively something which which tells you you are in a Gaussian gauge. Or there's also, you can add something so that you are in harmonic gauge. So that means you are flashing off the metric components of zero. So therefore, Skukash, Jacobson at some point honestly called it ESA, so there's ESA series. And there's very different DAS proposals, so you can add all kinds of DAS things.
So is the idea that DAS ether, there's some parameter that the ether has that kind of works as a...
Yeah, so the ether, so this is actually the idea with the DAS. So the DAS really comes, I have a picture there with the proper time parameter. The ether is a bit more subtle. The ether just provides you, it's actually just a vector field which is hypersurface orthogonal and allows you to have always hyper, nice slicing of a manifold. But if, you know, gives you third slicing of a manifold.
So the price is breaking Lorentz invariance.
So I come to that point, you know. So as I mentioned here, it's actually a very ingenious method. You know, depending on who you are, you can claim, I'm completely diffeomorphism in Lorentz invariant. Or you say, you actually break Lorentz invariants because you choose a preferred, I mean a dynamically preferred foliation. So depending on which, you know, whether you refer to the bare coordinates in some sense, in the bare coordinates everything is diffeomorphism invariant and in a sense Lorentz invariant. But of course if you express everything in these physical coordinates, as you would call it, then if you look at it, it has weird coordinate, explicit coordinate terms which you have, which you don't have, so which would, you know, which you would see as diffeomorphism symmetry breaking if you would, in addition, require diffeomorphism invariance with respect to these physical coordinates. So it's a nice way to actually systematically break Lorentz invariants in a sense. So that's what I mean. And usually I mean diffeomorphism invariance because Lorentz invariance is local stuff. You can actually do something similar just with local Lorentz invariance. So in tangent space, it's a paper by Stefan Gehlen and Derek Weiss. So all these approaches actually is a nice way to introduce these things. However, and to specify a preferred reference system, which in a sense is ESA, you know, that's the same. But of course you can ask, you know, what are these things? What is ESA and what is DAS? And these are of course highly idealized things. For instance, DAS, you know, I didn't put the meta term here, but the idea is that you have lots of DAS particles. They all carry a clock around them, which tell you the proper time of this DAS particle. So you can always, you know, knock on a DAS particle and ask it. They usually also have a little flag which tells the name of this DAS particle in the sense that, you know, it has a coordinate attached to it and it never changes this coordinate. So it's very good if you discuss the universe and say my DAS particle is a star. Might be a bit more questionable if you go to a microscopic theory and ask what is this DAS particle.
Is that DAS field homogeneous, like uniformly distributed?
This depends on your initial, because it's a dynamical field, so you have your initial data and you would just start with something homogeneous, I guess. So this is one aspect, and again, it's in certain situations, it's a very good idea. But there's some because there's some other stuff. Usually, you know, it depends how clearly you formulate it. It either cannot be detected, it doesn't really decay in anything, it does not interact with any other meta field.
But it interacts with gravity, right? But it interacts with gravity.
Yeah, that's why
it was detected in principle by detecting.
But in principle, by modes, by additional modes. That's why you actually want to tune it to be very light in principle. And that is only possible, as I will explain, if it has another peculiar kind of non-relativistic property, namely that the kinetic energy should be, you know, should be basically come with proportional to be to the momentum and not the momentum squared. And this is a bit kind of a non-relativistic property, as I will explain. If you go to the superparametrized particle, which was already discussed yesterday, you know, you have a Hamiltonian or a Hamiltonian constraint, where it is just adding up the kind of two kinematical terms. One is that you have a momentum for the time variable, which just is pt, and the other is the square term, which is just a usual free particle here. However, this makes a big difference for the properties of observables. So if you compute what is your relational observables asking, what is my position of my particle at a given time? So you basically just, you know, ask what is my usual position variable, you get just this thing. It's basically the q, which is your initial value, plus the momentum times the time interval. So this you can count as easily just by putting hats, you know. If you do the same for the so-called time of arrival operator, you get something different. You get t, so this is your initial t, plus, now it's the mass divided by the momentum conjugated to your particle, times your basically space interval. This is the so-called time of arrival operator, and you can, you know, there's an entire book of how to quantize, or that's impossible to quantize this time of arrival operator. So it's you cannot really put it into a self-adjoint operator just because of this 1 over p here. And indeed, if you consider this operator, there's a nice paper by Aharonov and Andrew. You get actually an additional uncertainty relation which just involves the time of arrival operator itself. So it gives you additional uncertainty for measuring really this kind of when does a particle hit the screen. So this was the easy version of the following thing. You can consider the two-point function in quantum field theory, and that gives you, it defines you usually completely the free theory and tells you how to resolve these kind of points in principle. And this is known as a Green's function, and usually just, you know, some standard expression, which even you can get classically by computing the Poisson brackets. So that's, if you consider the two-point function, that would be basically given by this, even by this classical expression. So now we basically asked for the two-point function of a given scalar field expressed in the coordinates given by four other scalar fields. And here I take basically four other scalar fields to be really with relativistic, you know, with the usual relativistic Lagrangian. They are all free in principle. You can even couple that to gravity, but and compute that to this first, to epsilon, and then this first epsilon term will be similar. And if you do that, you get the following result for this two-point function. You get the usual Green's function, like on flat space. But you get an extra term, which is basically 1 plus the energy of the field you observe divided by the energy of your clocks. So if you want to really, you know, have a high precision, have your usual result, you have to make the energy of your clocks very high. It just means that your clock should go fast, you know, to have a high resolution. Otherwise, you get basically these additional terms. So what you see here is basically a hint that you get a resolution limit for, you know, fields on space-time points, and you can see that as the resolution limit for how to differentiate between degrees of freedom depending on the energy of clocks. And there's a nice paper by Bedingshartl and Marolf from 2005, I think, which actually didn't derive it in this canonical approach, but in a fast integral approach, some semi-classical calculation, but the end result is, you know, the same. And they made some nice arguments, which are basically philosophically saying that, okay, I cannot resolve space-time points if I don't, you know, if I don't have a high energy of my clocks, I should actually not assume that something can exist with a higher, with a high density of degrees of freedom, which I cannot resolve. And the problem is, of course, if you think of gravity, if you make the energy of your clocks very large, you get a black hole. So that's the other reason why clocks shouldn't be so heavy. Be careful. And so you get a bound, which, I mean, you can go through this paper. Would be actually good if you go through that. In this case, it's even a super holographic bound. That is, you get something which even scales, which bounds more than the usual area law on the numbers of degrees of freedom. So there might be something, you know, it's kind of an easy argument to say maybe even the existence of black holes prevent you to have perfect clocks. So these are nice arguments which basically use the fact that you have to look for observables to induce something about the structure of the theory. Some other development is that Boyewald, Hoehn, and Sobanian, you know, introduced a bit of new language to deal with the situation that you don't have perfect clocks. The idea there is that, okay, if you know, you use some clock, and if that clock turns out to be bad, that is, goes through an inversion point, you just change to some other clock, and they call that, I think, fashionables, and had some more language, which I forgot. So this means that change clocks when necessary, and this is kind of also very interesting because it leads to lots of effects which are similar but generalized non-unitary evolution. So even if because you don't have one unique clock, you should rethink what unitary evolution means, because unitary usually refers to a given time. Okay.
Is this connected with the Gambini, Pauling, and Porto argument that the evolution will not be unitary?
The argument is very, so they don't, they actually say, they actually don't say it's non-unitary, they say it's a generalization of non-unitary, because in principle you can still have your physical Hilbert space, and then, you know, just a question, and a perfectly nice inner product, and then it's just a question, what does it mean to be to have unitary time evolution? So, I think the argument is different. Because Gambini and Pauline and Porto, they just start, okay, we have non-unitary evolution in principle. They really change the clocks and make the calculation. But it might be related. So to summarize this thing, so we have these relational observables which solve the problem of time in many situations and are used successfully, in particular for lots of interesting work in quantum cosmology. Kind of the foundational question remains with, in the end, you know, what can we measure if there is actually no space-time? And the nice thing about canonical formalism, it allows you to discuss this question. You could also say it forces you to discuss this question, but you cannot avoid this question. And one thing which, you know, the one point I want to make here, you can basically think of these ESA theory things and add some stuff which gives you a good time. This would include ESA, this would also include Tojava, and so on. That, in some sense, goes against the philosophy of an emerging of space-time, because you already put into there that you have nice time, in a sense, a nice space-time. So then, I think the emergence of space-time from this viewpoint is not really necessary, because you put in by hand, okay, you want to have a nice time. Okay. How much time do I have?
About 25 minutes.
So that says question to that thing, I completely changed to something. Yeah.
Yeah, I just had a question about, it seems to me that most of these solutions are being discussed classically. Is there a view for how that works out once you've quantized?
So the main problem Yeah, except, you know, for instance, this Gunetti paper, which, but you talked about it, is still this nice clause. So I haven't seen so much about, you know, dealing with the fact that this was a time of arrival thing. I think Brunetti, they were motivated to do it actually for the time of arrival operator or for these systems, because for the time of arrival operator use positive operational value measures. But then, if you really want to canonically quantize that, like for the scalar field, it's really hard to do. And, you know, I mean, I personally have some ideas, but I haven't seen so much work on really quantizing that. So most people really use this deparametrization in a sense, but there is some work in quantum cosmology, which I can give you references to, and this is mostly with a free scalar field, and then the problem is usually a bit easier because then the momentum is a Dirac observable. If you have a free massless scalar field, and you take just, you know, you can take, in these situations, you can take the square root easily. Because you have to source the constraints, and that's what you score the one root and take the other. But for a full scalar field, it's kind of, you have always this problem of 1 over p, basically. And that is a bit, even a bit harder than, I mean, quantum field theory, you can imagine, it's much harder than for the free particle.
I just want to make sure I understand the ether. I mean, so the ether in this, in the ether theories, you're really thinking of this as a new kind of field. It's not just standing in for the ordinary matter that's around us.
You know, if you really want to describe the world, you would take gravity plus the standard model plus ether, or plus dust, or whatever you want to do. So it's really different from the dynamics, from, you know, from the dynamics without this ether.
Right. Yeah.
Or you alternatively take scalar fields.
So you can't just think of it as an approximation to the real matter that there actually is? Or, you know, the observable matter?
On large scales, it's basically the dust, whoopy kind of, you could say it's dust. So this is the approximation kind of.
But that's not the view. But that's not the way to approach the problem. It's really an additional.
For instance, Ted Jacobson really takes it as something additional. Then, for instance, the dust, I mean, Kukoc, I don't know how, which philosophical point he took. I think he just took it also as always something additional. Then, okay, if you really open the papers by Thomas Thiemann, it's, you know, it says you cannot measure it, it might be dark matter. It's taking out something additional. And then the difficulty usually is what Jacobson, for instance, had to do for is to fine-tune all the coupling constants so that you don't mess up your standard astrophysical predictions. You know, in particular that you add additional modes to the gravitational field and so on. So that is really the hard part.
There's a point of view of global variables and theories of gravity that one author has discussed, at least in the string theory community. And so I'd just like to hear what your view of it is or how it fits into what you've been discussing.
So that scattering gives you all observables?
No, I would say rather you should, first of all, fix the asymptotic structure of your space-time, say Kausky space or sitter or anti-sitter. And then, when looking at diffeomorphisms, you should distinguish between diffeomorphisms which vanish at infinity, which actually act as gauge symmetries, and diffeomorphisms which don't vanish at the boundary, which act as global symmetries. And then there are gauge invariant observables, gauge invariant under local diffeomorphisms, which in the case of Minkowski space are the S matrix, in the case of anti-de-Sitter space, have to do with functions where you fix the asymptotic behavior of your fields. So it seems to me
CFT, how can you reconstruct the observers in the bio? So, and how can you understand really the structure of space-time? So these arguments were actually a bit more to understand the structure of space-time in the bulk and to see really what are these things like two-point functions. And to apply basically for also situations where you don't have asymptotic regions, so you speak of,
of a complex region. So you try to define local observables,
right? Local, yeah. You can see that in a sense it also can, how can you most easily or how can you most easily do kind of standard things in a local way. But then you see that there's a bound on how local you can get. That's a resolution bound. Okay. So let's come to the next part of my talk, which is what is vacuum? And you can do quantum field theory on any background or on Minkowski space-time background. And in this case, actually the vacuum, as you all know, is a highly complicated object in principle. And you can argue that it's a state of lowest energy. Then again, in these situations where you actually have no boundaries, so if you're in a compact universe, it's hard to take over this definition because in gravity everything has to have zero energy. It is invariant under symmetries of your background space-time, so in this case, Poincaré group. Here it's also a bit unclear, you don't have a background space-time, okay, symmetries, you could say it's a diffeomorphic symmetry. And via slightly more complicated stuff, known as Tomita-Takasaki modular theory and found out first apparently by these gentlemen, it might be argued to encode the geometry of Minkowski space-time. Another point is it's actually cyclic, that means if you take the Fock space vacuum and just apply lots of observers or operators on it, you basically regain your full Hilbert space. So there's not much what we can take over to a vacuum for quantum gravity. There is something which we call a kinematic vacuum for loop quantum gravity. Looks like this. So Daniela had it also in this talk. I don't know if you had this nice picture, but
yeah, I had it. It was without the box. So
it was it's really peculiar. So the important thing to say here is in loop quantum gravity, this kinematic vacuum is a peculiar state. It's very different from the Fock vacuum in Minkowski. In Minkowski, it's kind of a coherent state, kind of Gaussian. In loop quantum gravity, you in a certain sense have a maximally squeezed state, because all spatial operators, all spatial geometric operators, have zero expectation value and zero fluctuations. And in a sense, this is possible because the conjugated observables are not really represented as holonomies, so they give you something unitary. So in a sense, they don't have infinite fluctuation, but they are basically bounded because they are unitary. So you actually have a state of no spatial geometry. And in a sense, it's a very nice vacuum because it's really, nothing. It's spatial diffeomorphism invariant. Maybe. So here's just a little picture to explain you loop quantum gravity in 3 seconds. So if you want to write an excited state, it's similar to Fock state modulo the symmetries. So you don't really have any symmetries. So if you want to have a more excited state, you apply certain operators which you could see as annihilation operators, but they're actually these Wilson loop operators, but it doesn't really matter. So if you do that, this one thing, you draw a little arrow, this just means that they have a path, and you get this funny state, and this state actually tells you, okay, if I measure certain spatial geometry observer, which is called a flux, I get actually some non-zero value. But you have to measure it exactly at this position. If you measure it at somewhere else, it gives you zero. And so you can basically build up your more complicated state. Here you get something which looks like a tetrahedron, and you get these labels which basically tell you what are the eigenvalues of these flux operators, and then you can basically draw lots of very complicated graphs depending on your patients. And I had this little double tetrahedron here because the usual interpretation, you can interpret it as distinct geometry, but you have to take some dualization of this graph, which we don't really need. So we can create a highly excited state from the vacuum by applying lots of these creation operators, which give you a complicated curve. However, in a sense, everything which is basically somewhere where you haven't drawn anything, it really has zero volume, zero spatial volume, in principle, according to LQG. Very nice design, which tells you this representation is actually unique once you decide to take the observable algebra, which, you know, is provided by the Ashley-Chern variables. So once you fix that, which are these observables and the fluxes and the Molonghis, then there's a unique representation which satisfies certain number of things, and I think I didn't put half of the things, but this has to be cyclic, it has to be irreducible, so these are kind of standard things which you require, and you want also that carries a representation of the spatial diffeomorphism. And then you get basically a unique representation, and that was a great success because it was never managed in ADM quantization, for instance, to do that, actually to construct any representation. Okay. So as I told you, the graph is kind of, you know, gives you kind of string-like excitations. and you can interpret it as a discrete quantum geometry. Nevertheless, loop quantum gravity is a continuum theory. So how can that be? And this is formulated, or this is constructed via this concept of so-called cylindrical consistency in loop quantum gravity, which is actually a concept from standard quantum field theory. So the idea is that, you know, like these non-trivial parts, here you have a non-trivial state, the blue edge, came at some point with a label, but it's vanished, okay. so you can always, you know, take this state and rewrite it into an equivalent state. You can add an arbitrary number of edges as long as you put on these edges a particular label, which is that it has this dim label j equal to zero. And this tells you that still all the fluxes have to have zero expectation value and zero fluctuations if you measure them along these or across these edges. So it just means that given any state, you can always embed it, you know, into a more complicated graph and go on and take the refinement limit until you take the, until you get to the continuum. So this might seem to be something trivial, but then you get lots of consistency conditions, because basically you want to do a computation on this graph, you want to get the same result doing it on this graph. And so you need cylindrical consistent operators and so on, and a cylindrical consistent inner product. And this is known as the Ashikar-Lewandowski measure, which gives you the cylindrical consistent inner product. But this tool actually allows you to do computations which look really discrete on a finite dimensional Hilbert space, which are then valid in the continuum theory. So here's the limit.
Where does the cylinder come in the cylindrical consistency?
Oh, this came from quantum field theory, and then it was just some interval. And then it was doing this for something.
Okay.
So this is, I already basically explained it here, that you know, put j equal to 0 on all these edges, which still carry j equal to 0, which means that all the voids still have a 0 volume. So this is a nice state, but this is a nice idea, but it's kind of unpractical if you really want to have space-time. Because imagine that you want to write a base state which approximate kind of Minkowski space-time. And you have to put lots of edges with non-zero j's. So the question is, can one find a better embedding? And I will not present you basically a better embedding here. But I will tell you an idea how to get to a better notion of embedding and something which you could call a physical vacuum of your theory. And we have seen that, you know, refining your state plays a role. So fine and coarse scaling should come in. And so we go actually to an idea how to find the ground state in a given statistical system. So in a given statistical system, you know, you actually take a so-called transfer operator, which is just the exponential of minus your energy. And if you want to find your ground state, you basically take lots of powers of your transfer operator. And imagine that you have exponential minus energy, so actually if you take lots of powers of that, that at some point will give you the projector on the ground state. So it's kind of a lowest energy thing. If you have many of these things, you know, it means that everything with higher energy will be suppressed. So in principle, it also allows you to introduce a truncation here to the largest to the smallest eigenvalue of your energy. So in principle, you could truncate by restricting to this eigenvalue of transfer operator or to basically lowest energy. But the usual problem in, you know, these statistical systems is it's very hard to diagonalize the transfer operator if you have many particles. So the idea here comes from condensed matter again. It's basically that instead of diagonalizing the full thing, the full transfer matrix, which would basically encode the dynamics of all your particles, you do it more locally. So imagine you put your transfer operator, usually it can be written as little boxes, which, I mean, kind of smaller operators, which are connected. This just means a summation here. And this would be the full transfer operator, and the full diagonalization and truncation to the highest eigenvalue would mean that you basically compute here, put a unitary transformation to the lowest eigenvalue. So you would have to diagonalize the full thing. Instead of that, you can actually try to first diagonalize always two pairs. You do that, you find a certain transformation here. And then, you know, from these two boxes, you compute a new box, so it's a new operator. And then you can take again two of these, and again diagonalize, and so on. And typically, you can do that explicitly stepwise. So it's a certain truncation, it won't give you the exact diagonalization of the full operator, but in principle, you can do that in the steps, and improve your truncation also in steps. And these little maps, you can either see as blocking if you read them in one direction or as embedding, you know, in the other direction from one Hilbert space in the tensor product of two Hilbert spaces. So you get these embedding maps. For instance, after three iterations, it tells you how 1 degree of freedom, how we have to basically embed 1 degree of freedom into a Hilbert space, which is a tensor product of lots of these finite Hilbert spaces. So that is very similar to how FEG works, because every time you draw another edge, you basically embed it into larger Hilbert spaces, a tensor product of more basic Hilbert spaces. Yeah, have a little check. Not the latest version of my talk, apparently. 1 plus 1D. You can do that also more in 2D in a more symmetric fashion. You know, where basically these little boxes just mean amplitudes associated to your space-time region. And you would take four of them and cross-grain them into a new box here. But the problem is, if you take four of them, you have to do something with all these outer edges. And for that, you use this embedding map and get, again, something which looks similar to the original picture. So you basically have a cross-graining procedure and at the same time find these embedding maps. So here, if you, you know, continue this picture, you get basically something which gives you an embedding map over several steps. And you can hope that this converges and defines you basically the continuum limit of your theory. And a simple example is you can do that for the easing model and in the most basic truncation you can think of, you have an embedding that, you know, it's actually that the two spin zeros are mapped into spin zero. And, spin zero is embedded into spin zero. Here and spin 0 is embedded into spin 1, 1. So these are actually the two numbers which need to be fixed, and it needs to be isometric, so we have actually that these are equal to cos alpha and sine alpha. So then there are situations that 1 is embedded into 0, 1, and the other way around, but this is because of isometry fixed to be always 1 over square root of 2. So you really just have one parameter for this embedding map. And very naively, you can say that between loop quantum gravity, alpha has to be zero because it always happens that zero is embedded just into zero. So you always trust that it's been zero. Now we can take your easing model. Your easing model comes with a certain temperature and you can apply this procedure. And you will basically find that alpha changes with the number of cross-graining steps, and in the end you either flow to low temperature or high temperature, it's really just standard phase transition, and you do with a certain range of temperatures, and what happens is that you first go slowly and then very fast you go to either low temperature and high temperature, and here you are very much near the phase transition, and you see basically that in phase transitions, you get a certain scale freeness. Here you see that arising because you get a plateau where alpha almost doesn't change for a long time, and you can tune to the phase transition, and you would get a very long plateau, basically, where you would get always the same embedding. In terms of vacuum, it means that you can zoom in into your vacuum, and it always looks the same. Whereas in these situations, your system looks different if you look at different scales here. And in a sense, you could argue that for your quantum gravity vacuum, you want to be rather in this scale-free situation. So here is actually the explanation for these pictures. It really comes that in quantum gravity there's a nice version that you can basically associate amplitudes to space-time regions and have a wave function which doesn't sit on a given time but really sits in space-time in a sense on a generalized boundary. And this fits nicely with formalism in a sense because here you have a space-time region, looks like a little square, and you have basically a boundary which also looks like a little square. And to get a number which tells you basically encodes you the dynamics of the theory, you have to take kind of an inner product between this wave function and this amplitude map. And then this cross graining really is that you take four of these, you get basically this new amplitude map. But to get that, you first have to find an embedding of this wave function into this wave function, which has more of these edges, so it has more arguments, and for this reason it's actually an embedding. So the funny thing is that for this kind of cross-graining, you don't really need to think of blocking, but of you know, embedding, which is kind of a fine grain. Okay. So here's another picture which tells you once you know this embedding map, you can apply this embedding map first. You take your basic amplitude maps, you put them into a bigger block by summing over these blue edges here. You get this one, and you get your new, this defines you, this step defines your new coarse-grained amplitude map. Okay, so that was the same picture as before. So what we actually did is, I mean, you know, I told you that because we are trying to do that for spin foams and so-called analog models, which are a bit simpler than spin foams, because they are just two-dimensional, which are called spin nets. And we try to answer the basic question, which is there a phase which leads to a smooth space-time? So here would be, you know, are there embedding maps? Is there a fixed point which really gives you a smooth space-time? And not anything weird, which might happen. And so far we have nice results that we find at least, fixed points which could be interpreted as smooth space times at some point. So these are still in these analog models, and it's really a bit unclear how whether they really have a space time interpretation. But there are lots of these fixed points, which is a good sign. And these could correspond to busy realizations or non-realizations of the emergence of space-time. So here it's really the question to show that you get actually at large scales from your fundamental theory something which resembles general relativity. And the first step is to show that you get a space-time manifold. As I told you, actually these fixed points correspond to vacua. So an outlook is actually why the theory has an expansion of around these vacua. So I think that's the very foundations of philosophy and physics. Some years later, there's been the question, what is space-time? So now it's, what is quantum space-time? And I guess on these time scales, we can be even more sure that we have an answer in the near future. Okay.
So let's take some questions.
When you say the near future, it depends on your definition of time?
Yeah, on these time scales, you know.
Tom.
Yeah, I wanted to ask about, so in the second half of the talk, we were talking about vacuum and time. It seemed more kinematical. How is dynamics going to enter this picture? Is it going to be like in quantum field theory, where you lay out the Hamiltonian in terms of your raising and lowering operators, something along those lines?
Apparently I forgot to mention something. So the point was to have a dynamical vacuum. So indeed, the dynamics is in these little amplitude maps. You know, so these amplitude maps are, you know, the amplitude of your partition function or the exponential of your Hamiltonian, naively, and they, you know, they define the dynamics of your theory. So the first step, the LQG embedding, that is a kinematical stage. And now it's basically the question, given the dynamics, given any dynamics, do we get some other physical vacuum? You know, and so here is basically how you can, in principle, try to determine these embedding maps given a dynamics, and this dynamics is defined, is encoded in these amplitude maps.
So is this dynamics related to the constraints that we imposed in the...
So one thing is that, so this is a path integral approach. There's lots of, at this stage, we basically know that if you take the path integral, it is supposed to act as a projector onto the constraint hypersurface. So in this sense, it's the same as imposing the constraints. It's just a question which way is more convenient for you or for the question you want to discuss. So either you try to solve the constraints, or you basically put this, try to do this path integral, which in the same sense, in a similar argument like here, almost, not really, but, because this t is more or less the path integral, it has to act as a projector onto the physical states.
Okay.
Can I reach my parallels again? So I think I think I'm still having, I don't properly understand the little A boxes either. So I sort of get the idea of being amplitude maps, sort of unit steps and unitary evolution, something like that. But how are they labeled by edges? That's what I'm...
What are these edges?
Yeah.
Because it's just if you imagine if you're 2D, there's a simple version. Say this is your space-time region, and then an amplitude. Say this is a basic space-time region. Basic space-time region means everything what you want to specify about the space-time region sits on the boundary. So you put something on the boundary, and like in spin forms and in loop quantum gravity, these boundary data have some notion of discreteness. So for instance, imagine here in 2D, it comes really in this way, and say you have basically length variables or something associated to that. So then, given this, you get a number from this amplitude map. So this amplitude map, in a sense, would be kind of an action associated to all these variables, and it takes exponential, and because we have a measure, forget about that, and for this, A is an amplitude map, and then you get your edges. I mean, then, in principle, you would want to glue lots of these regions together and integrate over these boundary variables. Now, this graphical thing is just that integrating is indicated, okay, there it's blue, here it's red. These edges, and so if you glue a second region to this one, gluing would mean to take the sum over these variables, and here just indicate the, alternatively, it's basically indicated by summing over these red edges. So just some different graphical representation, which came up actually from Condensed Matter, and there it's called tensor networks and so on. And so these embedding maps, you can translate it into embed coarser boundaries into finer boundaries.
Is this a follow-up or okay, I have Jeremy next.
To suppress one question and take it from. I'm just happy to have it raised.
Oh, please.
We have, let's take time for both, so. We could just sit here and debate who's
going to. I had a very basic question about, are you saying in the final part that there is actually using these procedures and that an agreed emergence of the smooth space-time of the L2G program?
No, we would have to show that. I mean, that's my aim, to show that at some point.
Is it agreed that these are the best methods, these kind of dynamically determined from best methods? Rather than a complete outsider trying to
get a something which I'm doing since the last year, so the last 2 years, so I tried from the speakers.